Driving for his cell phone team, Tristan Wilhoit grabbed the pole in the 11 car for the first of the two 90-mile races here at Auto Club Speedway in Fontana, California. Rusty Babinski had a strong qualifying effort, starting on outside pole, winning at Vernon. Faber backs up that run by starting third here today. Zachary Fitzwater started fifth, made his way by Faber before he even hit turn one, and will now drive his way alongside the 11. He doesn't have a lot of immediate help as we've got a car upside down, down in turn number one. We'll get to that in just a moment, but Tristan Wilhoit able to sweep back in front entering turn number three, and it appears that he and Faber will be 1-2 coming to the caution flag. After causing a questionable incident on the final lap of race two of round 12, Alex Tanker was told that he would be docked five positions grid-wise at the start of this thing, putting him into an interesting three-wide situation. Midfield, Pichu London and Tanker come together, and it's Tanker who goes up into the wall and up and over in the number 15 car, rolls a couple of times, comes to a stop on his wheels, luckily. Allen and London drive it away. Tanker does not, obviously. Unfortunate for Allen, he had no part of this whatsoever, but he will have significant damage and consequently will probably not be on pace the whole rest of the race. Wilhoit takes the restart, gets a rather good one as he extends his gap to around two car lengths as they cross the line over Faber, three wide behind him with TJ Dent and Andreas Allen going after it. Fitzwater sweeps down in front of him after being initially caught up in that three-wide battle. Amin Al-Ghul having a good start to this one as we're on our only second green flag lap of this event. Rusty Babinski, Maxwell Chan, and Jacob Young now racing three wide for around, I'm going to say seventh. Ophelia Dumien and Sawyer Girl trying to make their way forward as Tyler Faber just drove by Tristan Wilhoit for the lead. Zachary Fitzwater still maintaining third. This could be a career day for him if he finishes up where he is currently. Some heated racing around midfield. Fitzwater has gradually made his way back over the course of the last couple of laps as Jacob Young and Andreas Allen battle for position. Look at the points leader, Gerald Reddington, making it four wide in the 112, trying to stick his nose between the 93, the 01, and the 18, as the 39 now becomes part of this, as the 01, the 18, the 112 rub. They bump, but they keep it going straight. Impressive job by them, and the 38 also manages to squeeze his way through them off the corner. Impressive moves by both current points leader and Sam Morrow in that 38 car. He's certainly got a strong car today. Currently on board, Richard Frelinski in the 71 car as he ducks low to grab position from Ali Nelson, now going after Sawyer Girl and trying to squeeze his way past Nicholas Samadio and perhaps Ophelia Dumien here if he can get a good of an, enough of a run. Not quite able to get that many positions done in one corner, but still an impressive drive up through the field so far this lap for Trelinski. Faber and Wilhoit once again appear to be swapping the lead here as Faber drops inside the 11. They seem to have a little bit of a take-and-give relationship going on so far today, probably just trying to stay in front of this hungry pack behind them. Rusty Babinski has made his way back into the top three. Look at Gerald Reddington. Just a few laps ago, we were talking about him being outside the top 15, but now he's cracked the top four. And it's with runs like that to the front that that he has managed to, even on some of his bad days, get a solid finishing position and hold on to that points lead. Amin Al-Ghul, Maxwell Chan, Sam Morrow, and Jacob Young four wide for around sixth position here. Maxwell Chan backs the hell out of that when Den tries to shut the door. Andreas Allen and Zachary Fitzwater get together. The four swerved like crazy there. I believe he might have been hit by the 39 as he went down the racetrack. We'll have to take another look at that as the ones on the apron. Coming off at two, the 44 just got a little bit too close to the 39's bumper as Andreas is sent down the racetrack into the four. The one also goes down the racetrack, hitting the apron now. I believe he's got a problem in that one car. No, he slides back up the racetrack. Not sure what exactly he was trying to accomplish down there on the apron. I think he was afraid of them wrecking there in front of him, so he got he noped the hell out of that one. Will Hoyt and Faber have been broken apart by Reddington and Rusty Babinski in the 41 car. Now it's the two CA Motorsports teammates, Faber and Reddington, side by side for the race lead here in one of the biggest races of the year here at Fontana, California. Reddington will lead that lap with some help from the 41 of Rusty Babinski. Zach Riel has also cracked the top five, sitting just behind Faber. Babinski got alongside Reddington in the 112 after a bad run for Reddington onto the back straightaway. 41 now looking to clear the 112 before they exit 4, preferably is able to do so, as the 33, the 71, and the 18 looking 3 wide for 3rd, just behind them. Look at the run the 18 had actually on the outside. Might be able to get both of them if he can make it stick down into turn number 1, as Will Hoyt gets turned around after contact with Jacob Young. They race 3 wide as they approach turn 1, but Sam Morrow would actually try and get to the outside of the 44, squeezing Young way up the racetrack, nearly into Faber, and Will Hoyt, who is trying to come down, met with Young, who is coming up the racetrack, and around Will Hoyt goes. Will Hoyt had a car that could have won today, but I don't think with that sort of damage on this sort of racetrack, he's going to be able to get it done here in this race. From quite a distance back, Richard Trelinski somehow able to keep that car stable on the bottom, and with some help from Reddington, he may lead the field to the caution flag, just the second of the day here as we approach the halfway point. Trelinski returns the field to the green flag. No one came into the pits as per usual, except for Tristan Wilhoit, who I'm sure wanted to repair some of that back lid damage, as Babinski immediately appears to try and retake that lead. No, Trelinski manages to hold on the outside. Impressive job by him. I think Babinski had to check up, or else he would have gotten into the 71 there. And the 112 might be able to get back into second if he can just get clear of the 41's. No, he's not quite able to do so. TJ Dent continues to make himself known up inside the top 10 by going after Zach Riel. Not quite able to get the pass done at this moment. Cameron Gadu sitting there just behind him. Zachary Fitzwater still inside the top 7. Other than Will Hoyt and Allen, who are significantly off the pace, other drivers that have not had a great day so far include Sawyer Girl, Matthew Nicholson, Andreas Allen, Mark Nutt. Don Thompson Jr. has done nothing notable so far today, as well as both of the Velvet Works racing cars are back here. Fitzwater definitely fluctuating as he seems to be able to charge his way back to the front, but he has been going between 5th and 20th. Around 20th place, so it'll be interesting to see which one of those cycles he'll be in when this race comes to a conclusion. Reddington's been trying continuously to get back by the 71 of Richard Trelinski for that lead position, has not been successful, and now TJ Dent has simply run out of patience for the points leader and is now going after it himself. Ty Dent sends it into turn number 1. With a full head of steam, gets into the back of the 12, nearly turns him around. Faber, I'm sure, not too happy about that bump from Dent. Zeus Morrow trying to get by both of them as the field sacks up really bad behind them, 3 wide for about 5 or 6 rows, in fact, behind them, as they have like a 10-car gap, car length gap to those in front of them. Man, they are 3 wide coming out of turn number 4. They might even fan out 4 wide as they come down towards the start-finish line. Definitely past halfway now, around 18 laps to go. 4 wide just behind Jacob Young, Rusty Babinski, and Maxwell Chan get together, and they go into the wall. Chan and Young simply converged on the 41 as they entered the corner. There was nothing that the 41 could have done to stop that other than slam on the brakes, which basically you don't want to do here at California, as proven by Carl Endumian's checkup earlier on, where it took him 5 laps to even recover. Once the drivers realized the caution was out, the mad scramble for positions was on. TJ Dent, in the 18 car, drops alongside the 71, the 33 with a full head of steam as well. Now going up the bottom, they were 3 wide momentarily for the lead, and it's going to be the 33, it appears, with some help from Annie Thomas, perhaps. The 33 able to lead the field down to the caution. Sam Morrow's the only car other than those that are damaged to come into the pits under this yellow flag. Sam Morrow has had a car that's been good so far today, perhaps not a race-winning car, and I think that's what he's going for. He was in the top 10. He doesn't have a whole lot to lose by being the only car to come in, and he's going to see how many cars he can pick off with just 14 laps to go. Riel gets back in the gas, and with him the green flag is back out. Here with just 13 laps to go, TJ Dent currently sits in second, drops to the inside down in turn number one, trying to make it stick. Previously we haven't seen a driver be able to actually pass down in turn one after a restart. The tires are just a little bit too cold to get enough grip to really hold the bottom there, as the 33 definitely will sweep back into the lead. Dent would drop to the inside just the following lap on the front straightaway and would be able to successfully complete the pass down into one. In fact, leaves the 33 in his dust. And the 33 with that checkup actually held up Reddington. And so it's currently TJ Dent and Trelinski. 1-2 here. Trelinski takes a peek to the outside. Interesting maneuver there by the driver of the number 71. But tied TJ Dent into the lead for the first time so far this race. Nicholas Samadio could have a very good points day here today if he finishes third. His points rival is right behind him, though, in fourth. Richard Trelinski and TJ Dent appear to swap positions here down the front straightaway. Yes, Trelinski back into the lead, but Faber grabs it from both of them down into turn one. What a move by the driver, that number 12. He wanted Vernon. He is looking for two in a row. He wants to repeat what Washer did earlier in the year. Tyler Faber has since been trying to defend both lines, both the inside and the outside, from the challengers by trying to run a bit of a line between the two. Has been swapping between the outside and the inside. As you see, he runs further inside than expected down this straightaway, but he might be passed by two at once here if he isn't careful, as he squeezes 3 wide down into turn number 3. Great racing here as Trelinski gets shoved up the track. Allie Nelson trying to avenge his fallen teammate by cracking the top 5, now going after the race lead potentially here, as Ty Dent also into the top 4. He made some contact with Faber earlier in the race, hasn't really showed his cards up until this point, but he will take the lead in the 83, as it seems a lot of cars have been coming to life in the last few laps. Perhaps it was better to save your stuff right until the end than to be using it all race long, as drivers like Faber, Trelinski, and TJ Dent have been doing. Look at Carl Endumian now, up driving by the 83. I've only really mentioned the one car twice this whole event. Once because he was noping the hell out of a 4-wide situation early on, and second because he was still in the top, outside the top 25, but now he's up into the race lead. And now it's Allie Nelson in the 9 car, goes into the race lead, rather. Sorry, I confused her with Tristan Wilhoit's car. They look simply so similar, and they appear to be driving just the same. This is what the fans have showed up to this race for, these final 5 laps here of the event, where it seems every year the drivers go completely insane. 3-wide racing for many, many rows here as Reddington tries to crack the top 10 once again. trying to keep his hot streak alive there in the number 112. Here comes the 38 of Sam Morrow up a few positions here as he makes his way up into the top five, I do believe. Impressive drive by him after coming in to get tires. Four to go for TJ Dent. He's got a huge gap over Bill Little John, racing side by side with Jeff Derry. With this sort of racing, he may be able to pull away and win it. Actually, all on his own, as behind this four-car group battling for second, it's simply three wide for about the whole rest of the top 20. It does appear Zachary Fitzwater, on one of his cycles to the front, barely avoids contact with the 91 there. I think if Jeff Derry didn't move up the racetrack, there would have been a rather large incident coming out of that corner. Sam Morrow now up the inside of the 91. His tire strategy certainly paying off here. He's still got 25 lap fresher tires than the entire rest of the field. And so it's going to be interesting to see if he can get by the rest of the top three in the two or three laps remaining. Fitzwater drops underneath Bill Littlejohn in the 30 car, the 38, looking in the middle once again, as he has so many times this race. That car really sticks on that middle groove. He gets by the 30 as the 30 really falls back. I think he had to check up to avoid getting into the wall there. And the 38 drives by the 44 like he was standing still, now sitting behind TJ Dent. As we're coming to the white flag this time, he drops down underneath the 18. The 18 tried to throw the block. Coming into three was completely unsuccessful, and the 38 will lead at the white flag. I don't know whether anyone has anything for Sam Morrow, considering he has those fresher tires. As Jeff Derry and Zachary Fitzwater blast by the number 18 coming into this corner, as the 44 and the 33 make some contact. It's the 38 with a massive lead of probably about 5 to 10 car lengths, who will come down to the start-finish line to win here in California with a great bit of strategy with around 15 laps to go at the time of the last caution. It was nearly a dead heat for second, but Fitzwater with a career day today, finishing second. He was dead last in points. He probably will still be in dead last. But, I mean, a second place certainly doesn't hurt that team's ego, as they need anything and everything that they can get for the remainder of the season to perhaps prepare for next year. Zach Riel in third in the 33, I do believe. Nope, just kidding. Jeff Derry in the 91 finishes third. He was the one that was side-by-side with the 44 coming to the line. It would be Zach Riel in fourth. TJ Dent led many of the last few laps, but will come home fifth. Ali Nelson avenges sort of his fallen teammate by finishing sixth. Ophelia and Dumian, both of the Velvet Works racing cars, made their way up into the front when it counted. Both seem to be saving their stuff, and she will get a seventh place finish. Bill Littlejohn eighth in the 30. James O'Shea and Richard Trelinski, both driving for O'Shea's team, will finish 9th and 10th. For any longtime fans of the HARC Pro Series, this front row is one of the more memorable ones. Sosnowski and Fullerton typically started side by side, but of course Sosnowski left the series after last year, and into the 7 car went Ryder Smith in the 7, who grabbed the pole for today's race. Gets a great start with some help from Kim Markell already going for the lead. As Duncan actually made it 4 wide as we're coming to the start finish line. That's insane. I cannot believe that just happened. And that they managed to keep it going here, as Julian Sanchez all the way up on the wall. Man, it looks like the final few laps of last race all over again here, as Fullerton rubs up into the 58, and it's Mike Doan and Jeffrey Fingai looking to crack the top five here, the 7 back to fourth, despite starting the race in first position. Sam Curtis and Brandon Krasta currently sitting on the podium after lap number one. This race has certainly been the epitome of balls to the walls, feller, as Bondarenko, the Russian driver, and Spencer Fullerton, who had a couple of, who had a bit of a rough incident at South Africa, race side by side, and it was Duncan who almost got turned around by Sydney Krasta down there in turn number one. Quite a start to race number one here. Look at freaking DJ Harris. You just went down and lane, like somehow into the corner and made it stick and got by like 3.5 cars. How is that possible? Whoa, DJ Curtis nearly gets into Duncan as Duncan tried to slide down and assist his teammate. Either that or get by him. More likely, get by him. Based off of what I've seen from Duncan so far this race, he's not been super patient. I don't think super patient's the best words for what he's been so far as Krasta and Fingai race for second. Really? Alright, Luviero, Rovac, Harris, and Fullerton four wide going into turn number one. Fullerton backs the hell out of that one, and it's Wheeler and Harris that stick together here on the top trying to make something work. Don't think that's particularly going to work this on. Maybe once the tires wear a little bit, they'll be able to get something done up there, but for now, the 36 ditches the 69 entirely. And goes down to the bottom to try and group with Washer and Terrence Day. And throughout all of this, Kim Markell has held the lead in the O2 car. Impressive job by that rookie driver to be able to hold so many other hungry drivers off for so long. But Fingai now appears that he will be able to get by her in the O2. No, the O2 still coming up the outside. What a car that she has under her belt here today. Fingai and Markell still side by side, and as a result, here comes Krasta taking a peek on the bottom, coming towards the start finish line to end, I don't know, lap six, I want to go with, as Krasta, Bondarenko, Mike Doan, and Markell four wide. Are you kidding me? As Bondarenko, Mike Doan, and Markell make just a tiny bit of contact. This is not what Mike Doan needs if he's going to close in on the championship lead still held by Reddington as they run right now. But Bondarenko somehow made it into first position through the middle. Mike Doan tried to do the same thing, but Fingai was able to get back down, and it's Krasta, Voiles, and Mike Doan three wide as they come out of turn number four. The caution lights are on, and luckily we're going to be single file for a few laps, and hopefully these drivers can like give their heads a shake and figure out what they really need to be doing this early on. Silver Fox currently running around 20th and has Michael Caine run all over the back of him as the 85 gets a piece of that. The 75's engine blows for some reason, and it's James Silver Fox and Sean Morrison who get the other notable damage from that, as Michael Caine nearly caused another wreck coming into the pit lane. Considering what Michael Caine just did by crossing about four lanes of traffic and getting into like a pair of drivers, Luke Walker and DJ Harris, it's a bit of a miracle that there wasn't a larger wreck coming out of turn number four. Luckily, this will take him out of the race, and he'll be able to sit in a corner and think about what he's done. 10 laps in the books here as the 77 returns the field to green flag conditions here. Jeffrey Fingai currently sitting in second, and like so many of his predecessors in race number one, tries to get by the driver in front of him on the inside, and completely successfully does it, surprisingly. Actually, the 77 checked up for some reason or another. I guess he just didn't have the grip to take that corner. Daniel Boyles still sitting inside the top four with Krasta here trying to slip down in front. Nope, not so much. Bondarenko and Fingai still 1-2. Onboard pole sitter Ryder Smith as he currently sits back around 20th place. The caution doesn't appear to have cooled down the drivers too much. A little bit less four wide, but certainly still three wide. Still looking like the end of the race. Race one. I think perhaps the lack of wrecks, or at least serious ones, other than Alex Tanker's first lap incident, has perhaps given these drivers a little bit too much confidence over their abilities here in race number two. It's Fingai and Bondarenko still battling for the lead here. Mike Doan still sitting on what would be the podium. Markel in the 10, and Jose Bautista, as well as Daniel Voiles, up into the top six. Three drivers you typically wouldn't find up here, especially at the start of one of these races. All three of them not particularly good at qualifying. Voiles has gotten a lot of fastest lap bonuses over the course of the series so far. Bondarenko shot back into fourth after being overtaken by both Mike Doan in the 72 and Fingai in the 20. Julian Sanchez forces the issue, coming down the front straightaway, and Andrew Rick and DJ Harrison William Duncan make serious contact into that corner. Duncan checks up out of that one and will lose a few positions. Still better than losing a car, as he has so many times this season. It was with a phenomenal effort that the 72 of Mike Doan managed to get by the 20 going into turn one. He was a couple of car lengths back, but managed to dive it in, just as we saw Terrence Day do in Heat 2 of last year. Bit of an obscure reference there, eh? But the 72 and the 20, still side by side off of the corner. Jeffrey Fingai really managed to get that thing load up on the back straightaway and carried that momentum through the corner. And Doan would have perhaps had a run going into this corner if Bautista had been a little bit selfish and went for it himself, but Mike Doan will manage to get by anyways. Impressive job by the driver of that 72 car to finally get by the 20, who I'm suspecting, just by the way that car seems to work everywhere, will be up at the front towards the end of the race, but not if they keep doing stuff like this, as Sam Curtis, Marcus Stroman, and Fingai get together what was damn near a really large accident, and now they're four wide coming down the front straightaway. Of course DJ Harris is part of it. When wouldn't DJ Harris be part of it? Julian Sanchez as well has been forcing the issue all day long so far. Bautista goes on a charge on Mike Doan. I know this isn't a super speedway race, but it is the largest track that the HARC Pro Series goes to, and they're nearly flat out other than a couple of small braking sections down into turn one and turn three. They're more of a coasting section as long as you've got a good car. But man, you could fit a lot of these, you could probably fit about 10 of these cars under a blanket at a time. Sam Curtis is the new challenger up at the front here. Jose Bautista and Mike Doan forced to run the same line for once, as Julian Sanchez has also cracked the top three in the 58 car. Seems all that aggression might have actually paid off. Kerry Davis sitting third in on the inside line. Nope, not anymore. Ilya Bondarenko overtakes for that position. Bautista might actually be able to hold the 19 off. No, not quite. Doesn't get quite a good of a run into the corner as I was expecting, and does not have nearly the help coming off the corner that Curtis has, as they fan out two, three, I hope not four wide, going down into turn number one. Sam Curtis holds on to the lead for now, but Bondarenko with another charge. Wow, Sydney Krasta, what was that even? Makes it from fourth into second directly through the middle after Luke Walker swerves all the way down to the inside trying to get a solid run out of that 100 car. Ilya Bondarenko got out of the throttle for just a second exiting two, and Sydney Krasta pounces, going after the lead for himself. No, Luka Obrovac shoves the 21 up the racetrack just a tiny bit, and the three SpongeBob SquarePants machine will perhaps be able to lead this lap if he's careful, doesn't have any drafting help whatsoever. But then again, Sydney Krasta appeared to have the help from Luke Walker, but was actually third across the line there to both Bondarenko and Obrovac. Bondarenko appeared to have the line into the corner, did not quite make that run stick, had to get out of the throttle just shortly after Obrovac did, and it's crashed back to the lead. Luke Walker running around 12th position right now. He's reporting an engine failure in the 100 car, actually, right now. And he will certainly stack up a few of the drivers of the field. Goes all the way up to the outside to try and let everyone through. Now drops to the apron to try and keep this thing green flag on green flag conditions. Really class act by the driver of that number 100. Tyler Markell and Chris Luvier holding up this group of cars just the tiniest bit. And four wide once again, Brandon Krasta, Daniel Voiles, Andrew Rick, and Tyler Markell to come together. And Rick, Voiles, and Markell get turned around into the outside wall. Rather, it was just Voiles and Markell that got turned around there, but that will bring out the second caution of the race. Krasta returns the field to the green flag after the pace car went in, just 16 laps to go. Krasta, Bondarenko, and Obrovac, you're currently your top three. A really surprising thing is that no one actually came in under this yellow to try and do what Sam Morrow did on his way to victory in race number one. You really got to ask yourself, actually, at this point, whether or not these drivers were watching race number one or whether they were too busy getting all dosed up on methamphetamine for this race. Bondarenko's certainly not wasting any time as he drops to the inside of Luvier and Obrovac here just one lap after the retaking of the green flag here. And it's Luvier who tries and squeeze between the 21 and the 77. Initially backs off to try and avoid making contact with the 21. That's good. But now he goes after it anyways. A nice safe maneuver by the 98. And that's something you usually can't say about a three wide situation. Luvier on a charge off of turn number two, has a bit of a run on the 77, drops inside rather early, and because of that the 69, instead of going with him perhaps to help him get by, now goes by both of them himself and the 69 to the race lead, driving for the DJ Harris Motorsports team. And the 69 will lead this lap, just around 10 laps to go for him in the rest of the field. Kim Markell is being a bit of a magician this race so far. She led a bunch of the first few laps, appearing to have the strongest car of the day by far, then was overtaken and quickly fell through the field, dropping like a rock and completely going out of sight for the remainder, until now, when it really counts, she's made her way back up into the top two and is going after the 69 car. That car doesn't look quite as strong as it did earlier, but that's probably just because of the worn tires, and also because the other fastest drivers have finally made their way up into the front at this point. Wheeler is certainly one of those cars that she's going to have a struggle getting by, it appears. The Curtis teammates currently side by side, the 16 and the 19 just behind the 36 of DJ Harris. Pericles drops to the inside, no, gets into the back of the number 16. That might have been by accident. Just wasn't expecting the 16 to check up there. But the 16, the 19, and of course the 85 with heavy damage after the collision in that corner. Fitzwater in particular had a hard hit in the outside wall. Just listen. Luckily, Fitzwater would climb out of that car okay. And that will bring out the caution with just 10 laps to go. Well, with just 6 laps to go, it will be Alex Wheeler occupying the pole position on the restart, with Sydney Krasta just behind, having swerved her way back up into second, coming towards the caution flag. Look at Kim Markell, though, in that 02 car. So strong she was early on today. I would not be surprised to see her and Alex Wheeler go at it for this race victory as the laps continue to wind down here. I'm not quite sure how some of these drivers like Julian Sanchez and William Duncan and Marcus Stroman still have even tires on those machines the way they've been driving so far today. But when it counts, they are up at the front as Duncan tries to make it three wide here with Stroman and Luvier. That's a bit ambitious as he gets shut out. No, the 98 slides up the racetrack just a little bit after trying to cut off the 6. Was not able to get the job done there. And Duncan into third, but here comes Kim Markel with the charge on the 69. These two have separated themselves from the pack momentarily, and I say momentarily because when they're side by side like that, Duncan and the rest of the field are going to charge them down in a hurry. But the 02 clears the 69 by about 5 car lengths. It's the 19 car, I think, went into the pits to try and repair some more damage. And is now back out on track just in front of this group right here. William Duncan into second. What a day it would be for him if he got up to Kim Markel and was able to challenge her for this race victory. Just a lap after the restart, Jeffrey Fingai, certainly one of the strongest cars of the day, would blow a motor and out of the race he goes with just a few laps to go. Really unfortunate for that team. Kim Markel well off into the distance as she comes towards the penultimate lap of this event. She's gotten by Sam Curtis with absolutely no problems. Duncan and Wheeler teamed up for a bit there. Duncan with a terrible run off the corner, and Wheeler has a tough choice to make to go with Duncan and be overtaken by Bondarenko. No, Wheeler goes to the bottom, and now Bondarenko becomes the drafting partner towards the front here. It's go big or go home at this point, and Duncan simply wasn't fast enough to keep with him as Doan shoves his nose in there and trying to get both Bondarenko and Wheeler after overtaking Duncan down the long front straightaway. Markel onto the backstretch for the final time with a lead of nearly a second over Doan and Bondarenko, who continue to battle for the runner-up spot into turn number 3. The 0-2 of Kim Markel will come off of the final corner. She led the first few laps in quite dominant fashion. It didn't appear anyone had anything from her for her at that point. She disappeared from the scene of the racing action, but appeared right when it counted, and she will get her first career win here in Fontana. Mike Doan, a well-deserved second place in the 72 car. That's just what he needed to perhaps get back towards the championship hunt. It will be the 69 of Alex Wheeler, who finishes at the tail end of the podium. Sydney Krasa, who had a very strong car, able to use any sort of line that he had available to him throughout the course of the race here today, will finish fourth. Bondarenko fifth in the 77, another very strong car. The 98 of Chris Luvier poked his nose towards the lead a couple of times this race, will finish 6th. Brandon Krasta, 7th, showed up early, and like Kim Markel, showed up again late. Julian Sanchez in the 58 will finish 8th. Don't know how that car has any tires left whatsoever, considering what she was trying to do with it earlier on. And Kerry Davis in DJ Harris will round out the top 10.